So we're going to start by introducing NCWIT. So welcome to the Academic Alliance Meeting of the Minds for NCWIT. The National Center for Women and Information Technology is a nonprofit community that was founded in 2004 with support from the National Science Foundation. Our mission is to convene, equip, and unite more than 1,500 change leader organizations from all across the country to increase the meaningful and influential participation of all women at every intersection in the influential field of computing. So we really are thinking of that particularly in terms of innovation and development. So NCWIT is actually a member organization of member organizations. We have an entire ecosystem of participants, and our organization is actually structured as an organization of organizations. And so we're gonna go, and I'm gonna tell you a little bit about today's organization, the Academic Alliance. So we can go to the next slide. So today's session is presented by NCWIT's Higher Ed Alliance, which you might formerly know as the Academic Alliance. The Higher Ed Alliance, though, is not just about undergraduate education. It also trains experts through graduate programs, including new researchers and faculty. And little known secret, well, not to y'all, but the academic place, universities and institutions are actually workplaces as well. So faculty, grad students, and all of the technologists who support faculty and students, especially post-COVID with all of the virtual classes. So universities really are a place of innovation, research, and tech development. So today's session is going to be learning and discussing innovative solutions alongside peers on two vital components of inclusive pedagogy, particularly peer instruction and curriculum development. If you can go back one more slide. If your organization is not already a member of the Academic Alliance, we definitely encourage you to join today. Membership is offered to universities at absolutely no cost and allows for your university and your peers, your students, your colleagues, everyone to participate in NCWIT's programs at a deeper level. We can go to the next slide. So today's speakers are Dr. Leo Porter from University of California at San Diego, as well as Dr. Cynthia Taylor from Oberlin College. We have Dr. Beth Simon from University of California, San Diego. And then finally, Sophia Krause-Levy, who is a PhD candidate at University of California, San Diego. So I'm gonna pass it to Dr. Leo Porter, who's gonna moderate our discussion.
Thank you, Brittany. I guess I was just going over a quick overview of what we're going to do today. Welcome, everyone. We practice what we preach, and so we believe in engagement and conversations, and so we're going to be doing the same thing with you all today. What we're going to do is spend a little time talking about peer instruction, and then we'll do some breakout rooms where you all will have opportunities to talk with one another about what you've seen and learned, come up with questions for us, and then we'll do an all-hands kind of discussion answering your questions. And then we'll do the same thing again, but now for prerequisite proficiency and curriculum design. And with that, I'm going to turn this over to Cynthia to talk about peer instruction.
Great. Thank you, Leo. So I'm sure all of you are very familiar with the traditional lecture format. This is the way we've been running classrooms for hundreds of years. We start out and we give an overview of the topic and lecture. We introduce our students to the ideas, and then they have to read the textbook themselves to figure out sort of the details and the hard stuff. They have to do assignments to see, right? We pose them these really in-depth questions to make sure, like, do you really understand it? And maybe that is what actually forces them to read the textbook. And then at the end, they take an exam to show that they've actually mastered this knowledge. So I'm sure that many of you are familiar with the new model, which is our flipped classroom model with active learning. And so in this model, they start out with some sort of introduction to themselves by themselves of the content. So they get sort of an overview, the easy stuff. They're either watching a video, they're reading a textbook. I really love these new interactive textbooks that are out there. So they do some first introduction to the concepts on their own. And then in lecture, they come already having some idea of what you're going to talk about. And so they're ready to really engage with the harder parts of the material. You can really get into the nitty gritty of how stuff works. And they're ready to ask you questions that came up when they were looking at this stuff on their own. And then again, you give them assignment where they can practice what they've already gone over with you in class. And lastly, again, you may have an exam to show that they've mastered this knowledge. And so peer instruction is really going to fit into that lecture component. It's a way that we can really get into the hard stuff that we want to discuss with our students in class and really surface their misconceptions and questions about the material. So how does peer instruction actually work in the classroom? Well, we're going to start out with sort of a mini lecture, right? So normally I go over like 5 to 10 slides of materials. I try not to go longer than 5 or 10 minutes, but I am sort of going over some material with them. And then I post a multiple choice question where the goal is for me to really get at the core concepts of what I'm trying to teach them, and also to surface any existing misconceptions they may have. So I put up a multiple choice question and they have an individual vote. In my class, this is through iClickers, but I know people also use a variety of means, things like Poll Everywhere or clickers. There's a variety of ways that you can capture the student vote. But at this point, I get feedback about how my students individually understand this concept. And then they have a small group discussion. So students in groups of like 2 to 4 will discuss their answers. So they've already come up with an individual answer. At this point, they compare answers. If they have different answers, they discuss how they came up with their answer and why. And ideally, they reach consensus in their group about what the correct answer is. And now they vote as a group. Hopefully, they all have the same vote at this point. And now we have a classroom-wide discussion. And I really love this part. I always make one of my groups explain their answer. So I have a particular group explain what they picked and why. And then we answer questions. We maybe have people discuss like individual wrong answers, why they're wrong. We just have a big class-wide discussion about the concept we just covered. And so why I really love peer instruction is this. I'm sure you all have been teaching to a classroom and you look up and you see a sea of faces that just looks like this, right? They're all just kind of staring at you. And so when I look at the sea of faces, I don't know if they're all thinking like, oh, I totally know this. I'm so bored. I could be learning new information. Why is she still talking about this? Or if they're like, I have no idea what's going on. She's going way too fast. Like, I wish she would really slow down and explain this more. Or if they're really excited. Or if they're just thinking about lunch, right? Any of these things could be possible. So why I really love peer instruction is that instead of just staring at the sea of faces and not knowing what they're thinking, I get a real-time histogram of what my students understand. And this means that I can adjust my class on the fly. If I get a histogram of answers and it's flat, like they're all just guessing wildly, I'm like, oh, I really need to spend some more time on this. I'm going to go back and do some more examples and we're going to really focus on what they're missing. On the other hand, if the individual vote happens and they all get the right answer or 90% of them get the right answer, I'm like, okay, we don't have to spend any more time on this. Let's move on to something. They already understand this. And the best part is my students actually ask questions. They've already discussed with their groups. And so they know if they have a question and no one in their group can answer it, it's not just them, right? They're like, wait, clearly this is a bigger question that no one knows the answer to. It's not just me. And so that really empowers them to ask questions in class in a way that they don't when they don't have this opportunity to talk with their peers.
All right. So hi, everybody. My name is Beth. I'm going to take over and again remind you that we're going to practice what we preach, because right now, not only are you guys not just a sea of blank faces, you're just a sea of black boxes. And so you're probably being very tempted to try to get through some of those emails this morning. We totally understand. But we're going to drag your attention back today and ask you to engage like a student would with a peer instruction question. So this is a question that I use in a non-majors computer science class. I encourage you to look at the code on the screen. It's okay. Just remember, you don't need to recognize this programming language. You don't need to know anything about it. Just using your best possible guesstimate, I'd like you to look at this code and make a guess at what do you think this code will actually do. So I'll give you a minute to read the code. And the answer options. And you should see a poll has popped up. So when you feel like you have an idea, go ahead and answer that poll. We'll give you all just a few more seconds. All right, hope perfectly fine. If you're not sure, just go ahead and make a guess, answer something. 5, 4, 3, 2, oops, that's not supposed to happen. That's okay, pretend you didn't see that. And what we'd like you all to do is to go, we're gonna have you go out to breakout rooms. Here's what you should do right now. Everybody grab, before we go, because you're gonna lose the screen when we go, grab a screenshot of that code and the answer options. And I can even upload one in our chat message. But we're gonna send people out to breakout rooms. I'd like you to take a few minutes to talk with each other about what answer did you pick? Why did you pick that? And then also, what's an answer that you decided wasn't right? And why did you think people might think it's right? Why did we provide that as an answer option for you to think about? And we're gonna give you about 4 to 5 minutes in your group. So don't be shy, get started talking right away. All right, welcome back, everyone. I'm thinking almost everyone is back. And now that you've had a few minutes to discuss this question in your group, whatever you guys discussed about, however you're thinking now, we're going to give another chance to answer the question as you think now the answer would be. So hopefully we'll have a poll pop up here in a mo. All right, oh, you should see a poll. And based on whatever you think is happening now, if you would go ahead and submit an answer. And as I tell my students, yes, all of you submit an answer again. We want your vote to count. And go ahead and take this time to answer. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Who knew that I need to get a PhD to learn to count backwards, but I do it all the time now. So when we've got a chance, go ahead and show us the result of that poll. Oh, wow, that's so cool. Hopefully you're seeing what I'm seeing. I see 33% of people have voted making the Eskimo girl say hello while jumping up and down, and 67 say just makes the Eskimo girl say hello. So it looks like we've got some things to talk about. I'd like to invite somebody to just go ahead and unmute and share, what did you talk about in your group?
Okay, I'll go. So I chose first B because I wasn't really familiar with the blog do together. I thought they're just doing these actions together, but in my group we discussed and somebody said, oh, but the up and down cancel each other. So it would just be say hello. So when we came back, I changed my answer based on that discussion.
Okay, that's one interesting analysis. Did anybody else discuss something in their group that they want to share?
In our group, someone said, maybe it does jump up and down, but it happens so fast in the bit level that we can't see it with our eye. So it depends on the programming, like sequential versus parallel programming capabilities.
Awesome. Anybody else have something that they want to share that they talked about in their group?
And we also in our group, what does the question mean? Is the does is the output we have.
Right, very difficult when you don't know what programming language this is. Maybe you've like literally never executed. I asked this on the very first day of a university class that's the equivalent of a CS0, an AP Computer Science Principles. Did anybody else want to share any thinking that came out in their group that they thought other people might learn from?
You know, some people didn't realize that they didn't notice the do together part. So they kind of skipped that part. Also the concept of like PEMDAS, right? Your order of operations and looking at the most inside in the parentheses, in this case, the purple block first. That was something else that was discussed.
It's always amazing to me how we can get together computer science experts and they see all the things. PEMDAS, oh my gosh. You know, order of operations, people talk about parallelism versus sequential. Let me just tell you, freshmen don't think about that stuff at all, guys, but they think about other interesting, difficult things. And so, Leo, if you would go to the next slide. Oh, I do need to say first, the correct answer, if you go into Alice 2.0, I don't know, not the most recent version of Alice, is in fact C, because the two instructions, the Eskimo move up half a meter and Eskimo move down half a meter, those are done in parallel. The way Alice chooses to execute them is that they cancel each other out. Now that's it, if you have one move up a meter and the other move down half a meter, sometimes weird stuff happens. It's actually not terribly well-defined, according to Steve Cooper. But because you all wanted to know what that answer was, right? You were invested. Awesome, next slide, thanks, Leo. So the key here clearly is that the content and the design of the question is super, super key. I mean, I could ask my students how many beers they had last night, and that's not going to help them understand computer science or understand something that I want to know about, you know, want them to understand about it, some tricky bit or important thing about how Alice works. So I always make sure to ask a question that I think most people are going to get wrong, at least like the first time, but maybe with a little bit of careful thought and paying attention, or maybe like 20% of the students might get it right, or 30, but the it's worth talking about. If everybody's like, oh, obviously the answer is A, then that's like really boring. Don't take time to ask that in class. Another thing that is often, like even I really misunderstood for at least the first couple of years I did peer instruction, is you don't wanna ask five answer options, A, B, C, D, E, just because you're like, oh, I wanna make sure I'm really knowing and they're not just guessing it. That's not the point. You want to ask, offer as many answer options as represent common misunderstandings or common wrong answers. And so that each of those answer options could make some sense to talk about and be like, oh, somebody might think it's B because maybe it's, you know, those are actually being done sequentially or things like that. And I do now fully, whenever I make any new questions, I ask no more than four answer options because that's just too many things to talk about in class. You're like, I'm tired. I don't want to talk about any more things. And the other thing is to have, when you're coming up with these questions and designing them, you want to think about what are my key takeaways? What am I wanting students to go, oh, about when they're doing this? And so, for example, as I told you, this is a beginning class question in a non-majors class. My key takeaways here are computer scientists pay attention to detail. We got to read all those little words. Like there was the do together and the do in order. And like one tile was on top of the other tile. These are really important. And also English is really imprecise because we say, you know, people are like, well, you said jump up and down, but it was moving up and down. It's like, yeah, English descriptions are never going to be as precise as our observations of the code or what actually happens when the code executes. And so those are my key warnings that I try to take, make sure that I say to the students as we're wrapping up these questions. You could put them on slides for students to have. I think that might even be better, but hey, there you are. All right, I think I'm passing it off now to Leo.
Great, thank you, Beth. So I think probably the most important part there was that you got to see this whole process and get insight into how this process works. Because I think that's, if for those of you wanting to go off and try this next, that's the practice. But I do want to say briefly kind of what we know about peer instruction in computer science. And this has been extensively studied in each of these examples I'm about to give. I'm giving you the one citation that will point you to it, but there's often multiple citations for each of these points. And so the first is that students really want more faculty to use peer instruction. This has been shown at liberal arts colleges, large research institutions, public undergrad institutions, in lower division computer science classes, and upper division computer science classes, and graduate computer science classes. It's kind of exhaustive at this point that students really like seeing this in their classroom. We then moved, once we realized students like it in the classroom, we want to move to their outcomes. Like, how is this actually changing what happens for the students? And we then looked to study failure rates. And what we found is that failure rates are lower in peer instruction classes than non. But probably most important for this audience, what we found is for instructors who switch from standard lecture to peer instruction, they see the same decline. So it's actually, there's a change there that's happening that's really important that seems to be tied to the pedagogy itself. We know that students actually perform better in the peer instruction classes. This is actually a nice study that Beth led at UCSD, and then Dan Zingaro ran a similar study at University of Toronto. In both the studies, they had a standard lecture section up against a peer instruction section. In Beth's study, it was Beth teaching the standard lecture against Beth teaching peer instruction. In the Toronto study, it was a top-ranked teaching professor teaching who loves standard lecture, teaching standard lecture against a top-ranked teaching professor who teaches peer instruction. And in both those studies, we found the same finding, essentially that students did about 5 to 6% better on a final exam in the peer instruction class. Now, being computer scientists, we started to ask the question, what does it mean for pedagogy to scale? And so we started looking at teaching evaluations as classes get bigger. At UCSD, we have huge classes, so this was easy to do. And what we found was for all classes, as the class size gets bigger, students get less happy with the class. What we found, though, that's really interesting is the slope of that decline is much more steep for standard lecture, because you've got one instructor trying to scale to 50 to 200 to 400 students versus in peer instruction, you've got students scaling with students, which is a really nice feature. And the last piece of that was particularly valuable for this audience is that it's also been studied in massive online course context. And in that case, what we found was that a combination of best practices, including peer instruction, led to higher completion rates for all students, but particularly higher completion rates for female students in those classes. What I want to do beyond this is share just one particular finding, which I think is compelling for this audience. So this is a particular process that happened back in 2008. Beth actually led all these changes in our introductory course for students without prior program experience. And what the goal was at the time was to improve student outcomes and improve retention in the major. I know it sounds crazy right now, but back in, you probably all, many of you remember, 2008, it was all about, can we get students to want to study computer science because enrollments had dropped so much. Now what happened is Beth made these changes, and then in 2019, one of my PhD students led the evaluation, a longitudinal evaluation, did this work. And the three things that got added to the class back in 2008 is peer instruction. We also added pair programming, which is a process of two students working together to solve assignments, right? One working at the keyboard, the other navigating, and they swap that role. And the last thing that we added was media computation, which made sure that students who were working on projects, they were working in context that was meaningful to them. So all the first time they did a for loop, they weren't creating Fibonacci series, they were changing a normal picture into a sunset by changing the blue and red components. And so these three practices got added. And now we're looking back and seeing, did it have an impact? And we looked at a really large population. I won't dive into much of the details here, but lots and lots of students. We had slightly different percentages of the makeup of the classes between the two timeframes, the timeframe before the change and after the change. I'm using here BLMPI to stand for Black, Latinx, Native American, and Pacific Islander. And you can see that we have slightly different percentages in that later time frame. And we looked at everybody across the board. We saw lower failure rates. We saw better retention in the major. We saw better performance in classes after this class. So lots and lots of good outcomes. But I want to focus on the impact on underrepresented groups in computing. First, men and women benefited similarly. So we saw similar declines in failure rates, similar improvements in retention, all those things. But I want to point out for the non-BLMPI versus BLMPI, it was a big difference. So here's the failure rates, here's the y-axis. And what I've broken this down as in dark blue is the traditional, and in green we have our best practices. Both of these are statistically significant, but here is what I want to focus on. Before the changes, almost half of the students who were BLMPI were failing this course. I don't think we knew it was that bad at the time when we made all the changes, but after the changes, we're down to less than 1 in 5. There's still room for improvement. You can tell that they're still failing at a higher rate than the non-BLMPI students, but this is a big impact on a lot of students. With that, the reference is at the bottom. I can throw this in chat while Beth takes to the next section.
Right, so hopefully with those awesome looking graph numbers, like everybody's just like super excited right now. And it's like, I wanna do this. And I'll just say that teaching using peer instruction is such a change in how you do it. And there are not inconsequential numbers of things that you need to be careful about. Using peer instruction is a tool, and you really want to use it as it is described in our research publications and others' research publications on how to use it. For example, when you do the first vote, it is recommended that you don't show the results of that vote before you send people off to discuss in groups, because otherwise the students are like predisposed, because none of them want to be wrong, right? They're like, okay, whichever one is the highest bar, that must be the right answer, right? So it is a tool, and we just want to caution you to take the time to look at things, because you can use tools badly, right? I really don't recommend cutting a pizza with a circular saw. You could, but your results might not be as great if you just used a knife, right? Or a pizza cutter. So do remember that there are important things to look at. We're gonna be pointing to you to a number of resources that can help you with that. That said, I also don't wanna scare you. Again, the first year I taught with peer instruction, I always showed the vote after the first, I showed the results of the votes. I don't know what I was thinking. I'd only seen it once or twice in like a physics class. So, it can be okay, but you wanna work toward making sure that you hit those sort of optimal sets of recommendations about best practices for using this in computer science classes. And next slide. So just as a nice visual, if you want to grab a screenshot, if you're thinking of doing this in your class, I am not kidding you. Print this sucker out and take it and stick it on your lectern, because you're going to be, your brain is in overload the first time you do this, because normally you just go up and you're like slide, 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 slide. And you're just like, what am I doing next? And moreover, I used to have a TA who would also help me out, or I was helping my former advisor who was still teaching at my institution, and she was going to adopt this, and she was a couple of years away from retiring. I'm like, Jean, why are you doing this? You don't need to do this. It's kind of hard. And she's like, nope, I've seen the graphs. I know it's important to do. So I just like, I went into her classroom and I found the three students who are always sitting right in front, of the lectern. I'm like, have you guys done peer instruction in your classes before? And they're like, yeah. And I'm like, okay, this is what she's supposed to do. If she gets off, if she forgets to have you do the discuss or whatever, you just say slow down. So you go back. So you take the individual vote. You don't show the graph is best practice. You always just have that discussion. We're optimizing, man. We're always like, oh my God, I have so many things to talk about. Look, you don't know just because somebody picked the right answer if they picked it for the right reason. Just, have them do a discussion. If you have a question, you accidentally made it too easy, you'll move it for next year and you'll make it better. Then have people vote again in the group, show that, have a class-wide discussion. I did not say, who chose B? Raise your hands. Okay, now somebody tell me what, that's what we're trying to avoid, that stuff with the whole anonymity of the clickers. Nice questions. What did you talk about in your group? There is no wrong answer to that, right? And I've had people say, we talked about the fact that we were really confused by this question. I'm like, great, let's hear a little bit about that. But what did you talk about in your group? Or why is a certain answer correct? Why might somebody think a certain answer is correct, but in fact it's wrong? And then potentially, depending on the content of the question, there might be some instructor modeling, some wrap up. For example, in intro programming courses, we often like, let's actually run the code now and show you how we as computer scientists run code and observe with care, attention to detail, et cetera. So you're really able to then, sort of show off not just like what we know as computer scientists, how we think as computer scientists. That's what I love about peer instruction. It allows us to model and get students practicing how to think like computer scientists do. All right, next slide. off to Leo.
All right, so what we're about to do is jump into breakout groups again. And so what I want to do is please grab a screenshot of this, or I'm throwing these questions into chat. But we want you to take 5 to 7 minutes or so to just talk with your groupmates, discuss any of these questions you want, or just any other questions that have come up during this discussion. Would you be interested in trying peer instruction? What might you make you more apt to do so? Have you tried it? All those kinds of things. So again, we're going to breakouts following peer instruction, right? So head to breakouts for 5 to 7 minutes, and then we'll come back and bring questions to us, and we'll have just about 5-10 minutes to discuss any questions you might have about this before we move on to the next topic. Okay. Thank you. All right, so I think we've had some time to all chat, and I hope you all had good discussions. I know our group did. What we'd like you to do is for this to just be a larger discussion with you all chatting with us. And so I think the process is to send a note. Was it to you, Chris, with the word Q? I think so. Or if anyone's willing just to kind of start things off in chat or in another way, we're happy to take your questions.
I think we're going to go ahead and start. So Leo, Cynthia, and I were in a room with April, who had posed a question before we broke out, which was about advice for implementing this in asynchronous or online classes. I was wondering if you had some advice for that.
So in 2016, I switched, and I offer fully online courses that are primarily asynchronous. One of them has like a discussion section once a week. And I still wanted to do learn how to teach block-based programming. So it's for people who are interested in learning to teach block-based programming in general, but also focused on K-12 teachers. And I wanted them to have the peer instruction experience, but I knew I wasn't going to have synchronous things. So I use a tool called perusal.com. It's an online sort of social media-esque interactive text reading. And it was developed, actually, Eric Mazur, who helped develop peer instruction as part of physics, they developed it to support students reading physics textbooks, because apparently, you know, nobody can understand a physics textbook, or like there's one person out of your 300 person class that can understand it. And so you buy the book through their portal, or you rent the ebook, and then you can make assignments and students can do that. I upload, if you are not using copyrighted materials, you can upload a PDF. So it could be a research paper. It could be, for me, it's my peer instruction slides. And then I ask students to highlight one of the right answer and write in their own words as a comment. This is sort of the way Perusal works. You make a comment or ask a question about an area of the text. And then I have them explain why the right answer is that answer is right, and choose at least one wrong answer and write why people might think, either why it's wrong or why people might think it's right. This is not, I think, as great, and I have not studied it to know even like what the learning benefits are, because people don't actually get to have that live discussion. And compared to my experience in the classroom, where you hear like, oh, you know, I'm just not 100% sure about that. That said, many of my students say they like it a lot. They learned by seeing other people's explanations. They liked seeing the written explanations. It wasn't like this ephemeral thing that like, yes, said something in the classroom, then who really remembers what anybody said? So they've got those to go back to refer to. But I will also admit that just based on the demographics of who we were taking my classes, the grand majority of them have taken a computing class using peer instruction at our university anyway, because they're almost all computer science majors or cognitive science majors. And there's a lot of people in our university who use peer instruction in their classrooms. And so hopefully that answers that.
I would just add, I think there's a tool Barbara Erickson's been working on to help facilitate online peer instruction called RuneStone, but I'm not sure how far I developed it is.
And if you're a campus that uses edX, the University of British Columbia came up with an edX integration that supports peer instruction in ways that I think are pretty good.
So Yasha also had a question earlier that was about how team formations may impact outcomes. And we were wondering, what best methods for arranging groups would you suggest?
I'm going to also defer to other people. The first thing that I think is important is that you assign groups and you keep them the same the whole time. You don't just be like, oh, turn to some people next to you. That is a lot easier to implement, and go ahead and do that the first time if you want. But especially, again, we're used to very large classrooms, and I know that some students just don't feel confident or whatever. So at the University of California, San Diego, you can go into any lecture hall and you will find that every seat has a number. It's like A01, B10, just like in a theater. And I don't exactly know how I asked for that in like one room. And then the people who are doing it are like, this is this good practice. And I'm like, well, I can't do what I want to do without it. And then suddenly they were everywhere. And that allows me to print out a sheet. They also provide like a diagram of the class and whatever. And I assign people seats and they hate it for the first week. And then after that, they're like, oh, this is good. Cause they're like, I got to know some new people in this class. It's a 400 person class. And I got to make new friends, and they aren't worried about who they have to come and talk to. It just reduces that stress level because they're responsible for talking with each other. So I think that's the most important thing. There are some issues, particularly if you're talking about intro programming and the fact that women are often, very underrepresented, et cetera. Then I tend to make the CS1 classes be groups of three women. And it's so funny, I sort it on a Google sheet. And then like, we're at week 6 and there are some guy like, said, did you notice all the women are sitting over on that side? I'm like, wonder how that happened. Don't know. So that's true. Pointing out about requiring attendance. So we do best practices to give points for participating with peer instruction, not for correctness. This is not a quiz, people. This is a discussion. And how much you give for that is, of course, up to you. I started off very insecure, and I was like 5%, et cetera. I was redesigning a new class using some students who'd been in my classes, and they're like, you have to make it worth 10%. If you don't, you're saying it's not important and it's not necessary to getting an A. And I was like, well, okay, if the student said that. So my typical value on that is now 10%, but it can vary. Most importantly, you need to be telling students why you're doing this crazy thing in the classroom, and that you're not doing it because it's easier for you, you're doing it because it's better for them. And you need to remind them that probably once a week. I'm not kidding you.
I would add a quick piece of, you can require participation, but don't require correctness. So there's even a clicker guide out there that recommends you grade them on correctness, and it breaks everything. Because you want these questions to be hard, you want them to be able to dive into it, you want it to be 100% formative. Do not grade on correctness, just grade on participation.
So I have a couple things to say on this. One is that one thing I do when I'm like really on top of my game is I survey students ahead of like the first day of class, and I ask them if they want an iClicker group that speaks in a language that's not English. And then I try to use that to help form my groups, because I find that one nice thing that peer instruction can do is they can do some translation work inside their groups. Another thing, I wanted to speak to Frank's comment about requiring attendance being hard. So I give students participation points for every class they show up. I use iClickers. I also record my lectures, and I have a form that's called the asynchronous participation form that if they have to miss class for any reason, they can fill out that form, and then they get credit. And the form is literally just like, what's the topic? What did you find interesting? Do you have any questions? But I find that still lets me feel like, okay, everyone has to do work to get this credit. So you're still encouraged to come to class, but if you are sick or busy, like I don't have to police it, and it gives students who can't make it to class another way to make those points.
Can I add a piece? I actually like Cynthia's answer more, but if you're looking for maybe a slightly lower effort solution, which is what I do, is I have a escape clause essentially. So if any points they lose on participation just moves to the final exam. So they never actually lose anything. It just makes the final exam weighted heavier. The big advantage to that is students who are really struggling to come to class know they can still get full credit. Students who really don't want to be there know they can still get full credit. But they're scared enough of the final exam that most people still do it.
There, just to add to that, there's also a good number of faculty members that will do things like, you can have your weekly credit come from a combination of attending lecture and doing a weekly review quiz, or there's a weekly review quiz that can take up all of those points, which is pretty nice. And then it's basically just extra practice on the topics from that week. So everybody has to do that, but you can submit as many times as you want. So it's basically similar to iClickers, and it just confirms that people have done some sort of practice by the end of the week. And I found that to be pretty helpful for students if they have things going on in their lives, because they can usually get it done when there's a larger window, and it makes sure that they still have an understanding of the topics they need to work on.
Looking at the time, if it's okay, I think we need to move to the next section, but feel free to continue to post questions. I'm not sure if there's a forum after the panel ends for us to be able to answer questions. I think we're going to stay after. I'll turn to the NCWIT folks for that. But we're obviously, email me. I'm happy to take emails and chat with you if you have questions. All right, so the next topic is looking at curriculum design, specifically how well our students prepare when they enter our classes. And I'll turn it over to Sophia.
Yeah, thank you, Leo. So how well are students actually prepared when they enter later courses is kind of the question that we're going to be focused on. Next slide, Leo. So I'm going to start off with the story of Amanda, just to give you a sense of why this topic is important. So Amanda is a first generation student. She is the first person in her family to attend college, and she's just accepted an offer to attend UC San Diego. Now, Amanda comes in not knowing what she wants to major in, but she's heard that computer science is a good area to be in, so she wants to try it out. Now, there's a few things you should know about UC San Diego. The first is that it's a large public university with 33,000 plus undergraduates. There's a large computer science department with 2,000 plus students, and the introductory classes often have 600 plus students. So Amanda decides to enroll in the CS1 course and starts her first course in computer science. Now, this image on the right is just to remind you that Amanda is one of very, very many students in this course. Now she starts off the course super excited. There are a ton of different resources for her. The lectures use peer instruction, active learning. She enjoys those. Those give her 10% participation towards her overall grade. She has lots of abilities to work with tutors, where she can get one-on-one help on the programming assignments. And she really, really enjoys this class. Now, by the end of the course, she ends up getting a B+, and she's really proud and really excited to move on to the next course. Now, the one thing that this grade doesn't tell Amanda is that she still has a fundamental misunderstanding with Java references. So Amanda moves on to the next course, the CS2 Basic Data Structures course, and she's really excited. Now, the image on the right is just to once again remind you that she is one of very, very many students in this course. Now, the course starts off and she's really excited and she's having a good time. There's the same resources, so there are still these tutors, this active learning, and everything like that. When they get to the first assignment, it's on linked lists. Now, linked lists relies really heavily on Java references. So Amanda begins to struggle, and she's not entirely sure why. She tries to use the same resources. She goes to the tutoring hours, but the tutors are more focused on helping students understand the data structures than on previous material. She's redirected to resources that she can use to help get the help that she needs, but she begins to feel overwhelmed, and like other students aren't struggling. She feels like she doesn't belong, and she ends up eventually failing this assignment and deciding to drop out of the course, never to return to this course or to computer science. Now, this story about Amanda isn't really just about Amanda. It's about many students, and this really isn't fair to her. That B+ didn't tell her where she still had misunderstandings, and she thought that she was prepared, because that's what students are told. When you make it to the next course, you're prepared for that material. So this leads into the question of how many students are entering later computer science courses less prepared than instructors might expect. Now, we began to look at this question to gain a better understanding of whether students are coming in underprepared and who this may be impacting. In order to do this, we selected an advanced data structures course, which is at the intersection of a variety of different prerequisite chains at our institution. So we have this, if you look at the right-hand side, we have kind of this little graph to show you. We have a CS1 course, the introductory course that leads into a discrete math and basic data structures course. Those lead into advanced math and computer organization, and finally to this advanced data structures course. Now, our goal here was to gain an understanding of what students knew upon entry to the course. So we designed a pretest, an assessment, to understand what knowledge students have when they enter. To do this, we worked with instructors of the previous courses and of the advanced data structures course to create a pretest that represented questions that all students were expected to know upon entry to the course. The goal here was not to make extremely challenging questions, because we can make challenging questions whenever we want, but it's to see what of the knowledge students are expected to know, do they actually know? So the pretest was created with the expectation that all students would get the questions correct on the test. We also worked by looking at validated instruments where we needed to pull questions from there. The test was administered in the first week of the course, and students were given 20 minutes to complete it. Next slide. So to give you a sense of what these questions look like, here is one of the questions from the test. And this one is on time complexity. So you can see here that there are three nested loops. And you may think this is actually a pretty difficult question for students. Students are likely to get this wrong and think that it's n cubed instead of n squared. This course, the Advanced Data Structures course, is the sixth or so course that students are taking in the computing curriculum. And they should have taken at least three courses that had some focus on runtime and time complexity at the point they're taking this. So this is a question that we would expect all students to get correct, and only 61% ended up getting it correctly. Just to give you another example, we have this question, which is focused on pointers. So the computer organization course that's right before the advanced data structures course is completely in C and ARM assembly. So students have a lot of time where they learn about pointers and memory management. So it's surprising here to see that only 69% of students got this question correct. These two questions specifically were shown to be very related to student success and their outcomes in this course. Right. So now if we look at the overall pretest that was given to students, we have this graph on the right where we have the survey score or the pretest score, and the x-axis is the number of students that received that score. You can see that there is a red line in between the 10 and 11 on the x-axis. This is just to show that that's a 70%, and only 29% of students scored above a 70% on this pretest. Now, it's important to remember this pretest is supposed to represent material that all students were expected to get correct. Now, 70% may or may not seem arbitrary to some of you here. It's a measurement that we often use to say whether or not students pass a course. So that's why it's being used. Whether this is the best metric, who knows, but it's one that people generally tend to understand. So it's surprising to see here. The other thing that's interesting is that 29% of students scored below 50% on this assessment. So this is showing that students were much less prepared than we had expected or knew this knowledge upon entry, given that this was given in the first week. So with this divide in understanding, how can we see students succeeding? And there's also this question of how are students able to make it into this advanced data structures course when they seem to lack this understanding of the material that is required upon their entry. The other thing that we want to bring up here is that we not only did this pretest, but looked at its relationship to students' outcomes. And for that, we looked at final exam score and course grade. And we found that there was a 0.37 Pearson correlation between the survey and final exam scores. For those of you that don't know what the statistic might mean within a computing education context, this is actually a very high correlation and suggests that there is a relationship between students' knowledge upon entry to the course and their outcomes in that course. So in addition to looking at this pretest and students' overall scores, we also wanted to know more about students like Amanda. Are there students that are from different backgrounds and have different demographics that are impacted more by this prerequisite course proficiency. Is Amanda alone, or are there other students experiencing this as well? We've already seen to some extent, yes, that is true. She is not alone. So we looked at the different demographics of gender, BLNPI, which Leo described earlier, first generation status, which is when someone is the first generation in their family to attend college, and transfer student status, which is for students that are usually coming, transferring to our institution from a 2-year degree beforehand. All right, so for these different groups, we looked at what their pretest scores were on this pretest, and we found that BLNPI and transfer students have lower prerequisite course proficiency compared to their counterparts. So here we have a graph where the x-axis is the mean score on the preterm test, and the y-axis is these different demographic groups broken down between the different subpopulations. So you can see here at the top, women and men, the averages are pretty similar. And I just want to point out, we're using averages here simply because it's the easiest to visualize and for people to understand. You can see too at the bottom for first generation and non-first generations, there isn't too big of a gap, but that for transfer students and non-transfer students and BLNPI and non-BLNPI, there is a larger gap here. Now, when we wanted to look at the statistical significance to see, is there a statistically significant difference between these two populations? We found that there only was between transfer and non-transfer students, with non-transfer students doing statistically significantly worse. Now you might wonder, well, why aren't we seeing this for BLNPI students when the difference is so similar? And we believe this may be due to the small n's that we had available for this population of students. Now, when looking at transfer and non-transfer students, you might be wondering, well, who are the transfer students? Isn't there a big variation within the population of transfer students? How many prerequisites they take in at our institution versus other institutions? What credits they came in with? So the thing to point out here is that we did look at the differences between how many courses the transfer students had taken, how many of their prerequisites they had taken at UCSD versus at another institution. And we didn't find any statistically significant difference based off of the number of courses they'd taken in our institution, which was surprising because we expected to see that students that had taken more courses at our institution would have been more prepared. In another study we ran that was also on this topic, what was surprising is we didn't find a statistically significant difference, but in that study, when looking at transfer and non-transfer students, we found that transfer students that had taken less courses at our institution did better than those that had taken more. We're looking more into this to kind of gain a better sense of what it means. All right, next slide, please. All right, so at this point, we've talked a lot about peer instruction, and for this subject, about how we are seeing issues with the incoming knowledge that students have. They don't all come in with the same level of preparedness, and we want to talk now about what can you do in your class. So, bullet, please. So you can give a pretest in your class, educate yourself to understand the extent of the issue. This will help you similarly, or maybe not similarly, but to peer instruction, how you can get a sense of how students are doing while you're giving lecture. For this, you can get a better understanding of what students are actually coming in with, what knowledge you may want to go back to, do a little bit of extra practice on, and just really where your students are at and what variety you see. Next. You can also look at the curriculum as a whole to ensure students are learning the ideas that you expect them to know. So you may be focused on an individual class, but that's actually within potentially a very long chain of prerequisites. So what do you expect students to know at the beginning of a course, in the next course, by the time they end their degree? And how do we address this? So a lot of the work that we've done on this topic has been focused on understanding the issue. And yes, you can teach the core ideas again in later classes. Ensure students know the core ideas before they're allowed to pass. So there's these two kind of ideas of not letting anyone move forward until they have the required knowledge, or continuing to shore up that knowledge once they make it to the next course. And likely it's really a combination of those two ideas. So how can we do better in our classes to address the diverse needs of our students? And this leads into the discussion. So I'm excited. So now we're going to have you all discuss in small groups. So think about what questions you might ask to gauge students' preparation. How do you feel your classes are preparing your students? And how do you design or find good questions? And for that, it's likely going to be similar in terms of thinking about what you expect people to know to the active learning questions, though we don't want these to be questions that we expect students to get wrong. So a little bit different.
We'll head then to breakout rooms again. I think we're going to change around the breakout room just a little bit so you get a chance to talk with more people. And we will come back in about 5 minutes or so and have a large discussion. Welcome back, everybody. We had awesome discussions, at least in my breakout. Thank you for the folks in my breakout group. I'll throw back up the slides, but again, same system as before. Please either throw your questions in chat or chat over to Chris that you'd like to ask a question.
So Victoria had a question before we went into breakouts, which is that, have you contacted the institutes that students transferred from and then let them know the students are not prepared?
So that is pretty difficult given that there's so many different schools the students transfer from. We actually, when we started working on this, had access to all of students' previous course grades from the institutions they transferred from. But even at at our institution, we didn't have access to which courses counted. It gets really complicated to figuring that out and making sure that if we're saying that it's true, because we only have so many transfer students and those are coming from a variety of different community colleges.
Yeah, and this is a support. There's also two other challenges. One is the variance. Right? You may have a student come from that school and do really well. You may have a student come from that school and not do that well. So we actually need really a decent number of students to be able to make a claim like they're not coming in prepared. I'd be really cautious to make that claim. And then as Sophia pointed out, the data, getting access to data is remarkably difficult at UCSD. I'm not sure how it is at all of your institutions, but it's really hard to know where they came from and how they given the classes, like Sophia said.
So Frank just posted, we discussed some concept about what sometimes happens, the unintentional consequences of discouraging students early. And I'm going to pivot that and say, what opportunities at UCSD have you used to try to encourage students early on to persist?
Well, we certainly have a fair bit of the work on retention that we talked about with peer instruction earlier. But I think if we're talking on the prerequisite piece, this is a study and it's really a project at midway point. We understand the problem pretty well, but we haven't done much to try to solve it. And we're actually hoping this community could actually help some with coming up with solutions. To Frank's question, I think it's more dangerous to let a student kind of move forward, not realizing what they don't know, and then letting that bite them continuously. And then they leave the program thinking it was a failure on their part other than our part. So I'd rather let the students know that they have these areas to shore up, but I don't want to do that without then saying, here's the extra resources. Like here's a chapter of ZyBooks, this nice ZyBook, right, that you could use to read through this, or here's a chapter in STEPIC. Like I think we need to pair any kind of feedback that they're unprepared with a lot of support to help them.
I think it's also important to point out that it's not just one student. So in the case of the hypothetical student, Amanda, she thought she was alone and that she was the only one experiencing that. So I think things like peer instruction, where you're actually talking, I mean, obviously not just that alone because we already do it, but it's important to remind students that they're not the only one feeling this way and that they're not the only one struggling. And I think that can really help them with moving forward and feeling confident, like, okay, if these people are also doing this and they're similarly struggling, then I can do it too.
Yeah, I think there's some concepts. That's a great point, Sophia. I think there's some concepts like pointers that no one's going to be shocked that our students are still struggling with, right? And so that they get into a group and they need help with recursion or pointers or these kind of commonly reoccurring topics in CS that are challenging for students. I like that point, Sophia. Thank you.
Yeah. Actually, one more thing. I just wanted to say the goal of this research and the way it's framed, which it's not to say, you know, our students are doing a bad job. It's to say we're doing a bad job preparing our students. So I think it's important to go in with that mentality too when you're talking to students and thing like, this isn't you failing us, this is us failing you, if anything, or maybe not fully. I mean, obviously the individual student might have certain things happening with them, but just as a reminder that this is like a two-way street and it's not just, oh, you've screwed up as a student.
Yeah, I mean, put that more on us, even beyond what Sophia just said. Coming out of the intro courses, over half our students are getting A's. And then we do these measurements like we're looking at here, and they're not able to demonstrate that kind of level of mastery in later classes. And so what's going on there that they're receiving these high grades? Because it's really mean if you tell a student you've mastered the content, you have an A, and then they actually haven't. That's not kind.
So I'm curious about what is your department's strategy for identifying these needs and then moving forward? Like what's the next step?
The next step will be trying interventions. And we're happy if folks want to pursue those with us. We're happy to do multi-institutional. We'd love collaborators to help us on this. But I think that the two pieces are what Sophia already said is, one, how do we make sure they're actually not passing the previous course without a level of mastery that's expected? Another is kind of helping adjust faculty perspectives, right? I mean, it's really hard. I'm guessing you all would appreciate this. I look at the previous course descriptions and I see something like pointers have been covered. And then it's really hard for me to then say, well, how well have they learned pointers at that point? What I see is they learned pointers. Okay, they know pointers as well as me. Let's keep going, right? And that's totally wrong, but it's so easy to do as an instructor. So part of it's just changing expectations of the faculty so they don't walk into the class and like, you've mastered pointers, let's dive into this really hard problem. And the third piece is in those later classes, how do we get them, if they're behind, how do you get them the help they need early? And I don't think small efforts are gonna be successful there, because if they took a quarter class and didn't learn it then, like a pointer to a website's not gonna be sufficient to shore up their knowledge. We need a heavier weight intervention than that.
So how do you get other faculty on board with thinking about this and redesigning?
We've done a whole bunch of work for that, and then maybe I should let Sophia talk about this, but we've interviewed a lot of faculty about the problems, make sure that we understand the extent of it. I'll let Sophia talk a little bit more about what we found with the discussions with faculty. That's one piece, and the other piece is just engaging the faculty through faculty means and things like that to make them aware of the problem and then try to engage them in helping us to fix it.
I will say that I think at an institution like UCSD, where we have a lot of people doing research like this, it's a lot easier to get instructors on board because they're used to it. And they know that when we're doing this type of research, we're not focused on them, right? It's not about them. It's about our institution overall and improving how we teach computer science. But I do think that it can be maybe a little bit more difficult at the beginning to gain people's trust to let you do research in their course, just so they feel comfortable knowing like this, we're not trying to nitpick you as an individual. We're trying to figure out how to improve this overall. So I think it's easier too when you say like, oh, we already have courses where we know this is an issue. So we're just trying to see the extent of it rather than saying we're trying to figure out if there's an issue in your course or something like that. For the instructor interviews, one thing that was interesting that relates to Leo's point about mastery is I think the term mastery is a little bit confusing in some of this. Like when talking to instructors after an intro course, some of them said things like, I expect students to have seen something before. Like I expect students to know what a for loop is versus, you know, how to implement that. I don't expect them to be able to do it perfectly every time. So I think there's different levels of expectations and different instructors have different expectations. So to Leo's point, you know, having mastered pointers versus having seen pointers are two very different levels of expectation. So it's good to get a better sense, I think, of what those expectations are by the end of the course, not just saying for loops, but saying have seen or have done one assignment with for loops or something like that.
Well, one of the really interesting pieces I got from your study, Sophia, was also the who's responsible question. So some faculty look at this and go, yeah, they're not as well prepared as they should be. How can we try to help them? And some faculty look at it and say, they're not as well prepared as they should be. That's on them. They need to figure it out. And that's a more concerning perspective, I think.
or other instructors. They'll say it's like, it's not my course, it's someone else's, or yeah. But there was the responsibility of the students, the instructors, other instructors, the department, and the institution, and kind of how all of those fit together. There's also the idea of the immense number of pressures that instructors face while trying to teach these courses. So I know when talking to some people, right, you take up the first week or two reviewing material, but then are you going to be able to cover everything you need to cover by the end of that course? Then there's also pressures of being well-liked by your students. And I don't know what the time to degree is in every state, but in California, it's 4 years. You want students to graduate in 4 years, and for transfers, it's 2 years, which is pretty quick. And it makes it difficult to figure out, you know, how quickly students should be actually going through this if they don't know the material, and also dealing with the amount of money that students are spending to go to school too. It gets pretty complicated.
Yeah, it's better for the institution for everyone to just kind of move through exactly as planned, because that then helps with time to degree, which is affects federal state funding. But we've kind of talked about the issues of just letting kind of everyone proceed if they're not prepared to do so. We're getting close. I know these amazing organizers put this together for us. Thank you, NCWIT, for doing this. I know you have some last things you'd like to do, so maybe this is a good time to turn over to that, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
Thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Porter. Thank you to all of our panelists, Sophia, Dr. Taylor, and Dr. Simon. We really appreciated your perspectives and you taking your time to deliver this panel for the Academic Alliance and for NCWIT. So please be on the lookout to all of our attendees. Please be on the lookout for a survey from our NCWIT evaluation team. If you have questions, you can reach out to us. It looks like I forgot to put in the email address, but it's academic@ncwit.org. We'll also send out a follow-up email with some of the papers and resources that were referenced here today, as well as the slide deck, so that you can refer back to it as needed. But with that is the end of our workshop, and thank you so much for participating. You can also use this QR code to do the evaluation if you're just like an eager beaver and want to do it now, or you can look for the email that's going to come out from our evaluation team. So thank you so much for participating, and have a great day.